paradigm shift.
An educational comedy.
It's not a cause. Not a movement.
It's not a social group you can slap a label onto.
It's an idea. It's an intention.
It's an intuition.
A mindset in which reality can be explored.
Through genuine expression,
discernment,
critical thinking, and imagination.
To look inward upon ourselves.
To better understand the external world around us.
And yes,
human egos are bound to be bruised.
With our silly, strange, politically incorrect,
George Carlin Gilbert style of going about things.
Real and raw honesty.
Which invites you to be
you to the fullest.
Kristen, it's
hello.
Me and Rich.
Oh, I was gonna call you guys soon.
Well, we beat you to it, so haha.
Alright, I'm gonna be honest, I've come to make a decision about something.
Okay.
How about you guys first, going on with you guys?
I sent you one thing that has been going on, a little link that I think might amuse you.
Mm-hmm.
Fucking owned a little butthurt troll. So
I was gonna look at that soon. I was gonna look at that before I sent you, but yeah.
Yeah, it's been interesting and contrasty these last couple of days. So, what is this thing that you're wanting to make a decision on?
Oh, well, how's Rich doing?
Oh, I'm doing good.
Actually, let's test the energetic waters here and see what the energies will allow for as far as who can actually get on this frickin' conversation. Time to expand. Calling Daphne.
I don't know how to talk to Daphne.
Hey Daphne.
Hey.
You're on the line with me and Kristen and Rich.
Oh, hi. I was going to say, it sounds like a party.
Hi, fine.
Over here. Hello, Daphne. Stop. It's not as happy as this one sounding, though. Hey, guys.
Hello. We are all here. And yeah, last couple of days have been quite contrasty, so this is like the contrast party line.
Yeah, same.
I have cranky, super cranky kids. I'm dealing with a cranky no-napper.
Mirror.
He's just screaming and crying. Well, he's just, you know.
Well, it's still a mirror.
He has not been met.
Yep. Just like you have been allowing yourself to meet some of your own needs, so your inner child has been screaming, being reflected on the external. The literal child.
He's just, well, I don't know so much about that when it comes to just not, he's lack of sleep. So he would be screaming, crying no matter what, without sleep.
Well, look at the timing of it. Look at the alignment of it. What does that represent? Obviously, lack of sleep means he's not quite getting exactly that which he needs, and he's placing stress upon himself, which only exacerbates the problem. What have you been doing?
All right. Shut up.
Yours being a troll.
Yeah, you were. Is today troll day? It's troll day for today?
Oh, yeah, Katerina's facing a lot of contrast, and it's her birthday.
Yeah.
She's just getting contrast reamed. I've been facing contrast with ease and flow, which contradicts my old paradigms that says, no, contrast has to be suffering and misery. It can't be ease and flow.
Yeah, I've been doing a lot more ease and flow myself and just letting go.
And of course, and I'm just going to put this out there to just kind of move through it, to put it on the table and get it discussed and rectified. Well, one thing that Kristen's been dealing with, just generally speaking, is feeling like she doesn't know how to talk to new people that she doesn't know very well yet. So that's anybody, everybody. That's pretty much universal. So I think Kristen needs some love and kindness from Daphne.
Yeah, and you know what's funny, Kristen, is that I actually went through that myself a few weeks ago, reacclimating to, like, adult life, as silly as that is. You know, not because most of my friends, you know, exited my life because my vibration changed and we were all not in alignment anymore. And I actually gave this advice out to somebody last night, so, which is obviously a coincidence, or not a coincidence, synchronicity. But it was just about honoring yourself. Like, forget about everybody else. It doesn't matter what everybody else thinks or does, because they're going to think and do whatever they think and do, regardless of what you think and do.
No, that's so, not, that's just to correct it, that's not apathy and narcissism. That's not like me only. Fuck everybody.
No, it's not about that. It's about honoring yourself, because how do you feel when you want to talk to people, but you don't? Yeah. I do want an answer. That's not a rhetorical question.
I hate that feeling.
And you have that feeling because you're not honoring yourself. And I'm learning that any icky feeling I have is because I'm not honoring what is in my highest and best and what it is that I really want to do. You know, like, you really want to talk to these people, but then you allow your fear of the unknown, what they might say or what they might do in response to you. But ultimately, you know, they're either going to clear themselves from your reality or they're going to be in alignment, and you just found yourself a new friend. And I really hesitated for the last couple of years making any sort of deep friendship. Dave can attest to that.
Yep.
You know, it's been been very hesitant.
I think I can attest to something that I think would be important to point out for Kristen's benefit. On conversations, you know, exactly like this one, it's not that Daphne lacks nervousness. It's not that she isn't terrified. It's not that all the stuff isn't coming up. She's just deciding, okay, well, I'm just going to be confident and face this and, you know, come what may, so be it. So, you know, she is feeling the same way on this conversation and, you know, many others, and with you and with many other people, the same way, you know, you've been feeling, you know, with Brian and with Jackson and with Daphne and with Katerina and with many other people. It's just that Daphne's come to a point where she's like, fuck it, I'm just going to be me anyway and come what may. And she's allowing the quantum mirror to reflect that, doing that actually isn't so bad. It's getting more positive receptivity than I thought. I mean, hell.
Absolutely. And across Daphne, the board, too.
If you want nervousness, Kristen, just Daphne getting to know me was and has been a very nervous prospect for her. I'm just a major mirror for her, and yeah.
Absolutely, like almost perfect mirror. I mean, and it, you know, there's only so long you can deal with the way that you've been doing things, that it really is just a matter of giving in because you're exhausted, continuing to do what you're doing. And that's the point that I reached, and I certainly don't want anybody else to reach that point. I obviously don't have any control over that, but, you know, it really was I just literally exhausted myself doing things the way that my ego wanted to do them, because I felt justified because my entire life I had spent doing for everybody else. So I was not aware that I was just slipping into a different frame of unconsciousness. I just went from one to another. And then I read something about honoring myself and what that really means. And it really is the only thing that you can do. And I, you know, in a conversation I had last night where I was giving the same advice, except for the friend that reached out to me was having an issue with a friend of hers who she said that there's a very one-sided relationship. She feels like she's giving, 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 and her friend's just taking, taking, taking. And, you know, and then she goes, but I'm just too nice to say anything to her. And I asked her, I said, well, are you too nice or are you just afraid what might happen? And she goes, well, maybe a little bit of both. And I, well, what's going to happen? You know, what's going to happen if you talk to those people? What's going to happen if you say what you really, like, would want to say to honor yourself? And I'm not saying, like, you know, if you're, like, pissed off somebody, you want to scream and yell at them, well, that's not coming from a place of honoring yourself. Because that's not really what you would want to do with that person, you know? And it just, it takes time. It's not something that's overnight as much as we all want this instant gratification, but it takes practice. And knowing that it's going to work and just releasing how long it's going to take you to feel comfortable about it, you know, like you're just stuck because you want it all to be corrupted now. And you're just going to hold yourself back until you figure out that you just have to take a little step, you know? And, you know, let your freak flag fly. You know, we all, and it's not a bad thing. You are who you are. And, you know, I built a lot of relationships based off of acquiescing and compromising and what I thought was going with the flow. But what I was really doing was ignoring myself and what I really wanted to do, and I ended up with a bunch of friends who I had a lot of fun with, but all we did was party, and there really wasn't anything deeper. And one of my so-called best friends, we got really intoxicated one night, and she was talking about marrying her boyfriend, and I flat out told her that I didn't support it because I just brought everything to life for her. I'm like, you constantly cheat on him, and not only are you constantly cheating on him, but you're cheating on him with your ex-boyfriend. And, but you tell me you want to marry this guy? Like, that's, I mean, that just
I have a question for everybody.
Yeah.
Would it be cool, do I have everybody's, permission to take this call and turn it into PSEC 2015, honoring yourself? Would that be okay?
Sure.
Okay. I don't do things like that without permission, because I'm not a dick, so, yeah.
Absolutely, thank you, I appreciate it. So we had this, like, heart to heart, and I basically just told her how I felt and how I thought she was making a huge mistake, and, you know, and that really she, you know, he's not the right person for her, that he doesn't bring out the best in her, you know, and all of these things that she would really want your friend to tell you. And she basically told me to shut the fuck up, and she didn't care what I had to say, and I hurt her feelings and never to share how I feel about her and her relationships again. And ultimately, let's see. So fast forward. So that happened in early 2013.
Richard will be right back. He's going to mute the line. Oh, okay. And he's got a vacuum right quick. So just like,
okay.
He's taking leave.
So fast forward about a year and it starts happening. You know, she goes with him and picks out her own ring and basically forces him to buy a ring that he doesn't want to buy. He won't give it to her, until, I don't even know, he wouldn't give it to her. And then they found out she was pregnant. And then they ended up getting, planning a wedding and all of this. And she asked me to be her matron of honor. And early, was it earlier this year? I don't know. It doesn't really matter. But she asked me to be her matron of honor. And then next thing I know, I get a wedding invitation in the mail. And the wedding is in 2 months. I don't have a dress or anything. She moved the date up by 6 months and didn't say a word to me. I've been asking her to help her with stuff, and she tells me she doesn't need any help. And then I get the invitation. I'm like, what's going on? And she's like, oh, well, you didn't really seem that interested, and you didn't want to help, so it's too late to be in the wedding party. And I'm like, and I stood up for myself, and I honored myself in the moment, and I said, you know, Bree, I'm really sorry that our friendship is not strong enough for you to come to me when you are feeling like I've done something wrong in our friendship, or that I'm not, you know, being a good friend. Like, I really thought our relationship was a lot stronger than that, but it obviously isn't, and I see how our friendship is valued. So, you know, I won't be at the wedding. I wish you all the best of luck, and I'm going to leave things amicable. And that's all I did. And she texted me probably like 2 months after that, because I had an article of clothing of hers, so I ended up just giving it to a mutual friend of ours. And, you know, and that's been it. And she is still, you know, married. She had that baby. She's not working. Her, you know, they're doing the exact same thing. I mean, I really don't even know, because I don't keep up with her anymore. you know, but this was supposed to be a person that was there for me no matter what. But when I was really there for her, and like, and maybe my words weren't the right, but she chose to just, you know, not have a friendship with me. And, you know, that bothered me for a really long time. And I thought, well, you know, what's wrong with me? Was I not interested? Well, you know what? Honestly, I probably wasn't as interested as I could have been. But any time that she reached out to me, I was engaged and giving my honest opinion and all of that. And, you know, the last thing I had heard about was dresses, you know, that we were going to go look at dresses. And then I never heard anything at all. And, you know, there were certainly things I wish that maybe I had done a little bit differently, and maybe I had, but it is what it is, and I came from the best place that I thought in the moment, and I have to be okay with that and allow her to honor herself, even if it's not what I want, you know? And it's okay, because it cleared the room for people who really do love and support me, and I'm not chasing a friendship that doesn't mean something to the other person, and it's okay. You know, I'm not, like, bawling my eyes out because I'm not best friends with the thing, with the girl I was best friends with in third grade, you know, but I still have her on Facebook and we talk occasionally, you know, and it's just a matter of perspective, like, especially you being under the rule of adults and having big people around, there's this, you know, they like to take away your power, but they can't. Like, even if you have to sit in your room and you're without the internet and without TV and, you know, they give you nothing but books, you still have an option to, you know, like, honor yourself in that without getting upset about it, and understand that, you know, your parents are just being however they are and in the moment, and it has nothing to do with you at all. They could have had a bad day at work. They could have been, you know, gotten in a fight with your other parent and you don't know about it. You know, they could have gotten, you know, cut off on the way home, who knows, but it has nothing to do with you, and that is so key. In honoring yourself, you realize that nothing has anything to do with anybody else, because you realize that the place that you're coming from has nothing to do with anybody else. You know, it's a process.
I'm totally getting lots and lots of reflections that are themed on that. I'm even getting notes dropped in on DeviantArt that are themed on that, and oh, all sorts of, it's like September is like Honor Yourself Month or some shit. I mean, it's like, you know, wow. Quantum Mirror's just going nuts.
right, and you know, it's, I actually just got off the phone with my life coach about an hour ago, and we were talking about this, and you know, every time that I've honored myself in the last week is when I've really been picking up on it, and you know, even to the point where I'm honoring however it is that I'm feeling too, not just the good stuff, but allowing the bad stuff, and it feels good, because then it's like, well, I don't have to justify myself to anybody else at all. I can just, and Dave, you said this to me the other day, just doing it because I want to do it, and there is no other reason. Like, I don't need any other reason. I don't have to justify it to anybody else, and they don't have to understand. And that was a huge thing for me, is because I want everybody to understand what I'm doing so that they don't think that I'm this malicious person. But I spent all my time, like, essentially justifying myself, even though I took it as, like, I'm just explaining myself. Well, no, I'm not. I'm justifying what I'm doing so that they're okay with it, so that I can continue to move forward without a problem from them. And that is so much more work than just going, I'm just going to do it because it feels good and I want to and I'm honoring myself. It's so much simpler.
Yep.
And, you know, everything really is simple. We just overcomplicate it all. We give ourselves all of these things, and it's, you know, it doesn't begin our conscious acceptance of it. It's just what everybody else does around us. So when we change up the story and we're doing something different, we look like the oddball. You know, like, have you seen the movie Inception, Kristen?
No.
That may or may not. That I have. That may or may not be one of the ones I put on your hard drive. You might have to check.
Okay. Well, that one is amazing, especially if you view it from the point of it being about life. And what they, in a part of it, it's in the beginning, and this isn't going to ruin the movie at all, but it's about they create, or literally creating dream worlds to bring their consciousnesses into in order to access information in people's subconscious minds they may be hiding. They extract information that way. So they create these worlds, and let's say it's my dream and this world is created. Well, if you come into my dream and you start doing weird things, all of the people in my dream are going to look at you and you're going to stand out. Well, that happens in real life. So when you're doing something and you're doing something, all of a sudden you decide to do something different, everybody looks at you and everybody takes notice because you have created a new, you know, a new wave. And it's not what they're used to seeing. And some people accept it and some people will fight back. So, and it's not that they're fighting back because they're against you. They're only fighting back because you're changing the story and they don't know what to do. And it's not your job, it's not your responsibility to tell them what they need to do in response to whatever it is that you've done. Your only job is to do, to honor yourself and continue to honor yourself no matter what anybody else's responses are or how they make you, because they can't make you feel anything.
And to honor everybody else's right to do the same. That way you're not really going to take anything personally. You're just going to see the quantum mirror reflection, so to speak, and you're not going to be like, how dare they have a negative view of me?
Exactly.
How
it's
dare
like,
they?
If you're,
like, well, wait a minute. Right. How dare me for saying how dare them? You know what I mean?
Exactly. It's like if I have a chocolate ice cream cone and you have a vanilla and you tell me I don't like chocolate and then I start bagging on your vanilla, well, that's totally unnecessary. It's like, oh, okay, well, you just must prefer vanilla, yeah? Oh, okay. You know, it's just as simple. You're just changing the subject matter that's in there, but we decide as humans that an event or a situation has more value than some other situation, when in reality, it doesn't. It just is what it is. It's only a big situation because we make it that way. And the argument against that, and I can hear it coming from whoever is going to listen/watch to this, is that, well, if you don't, then you're just acquiescing and you're not standing up. Well, we're not trying to fight against anything. We're learning to honor ourselves and honor others where they are. And it's not turning a blind eye to anything. It's just like Dave, I love this, just stepping off the hamster wheel.
Sir, I missed like the last three words.
Oh, I said stepping off the hamster wheel.
Oh, yes, yes.
Yeah, and that's really all it is. And I, you know, and it's so... It's taken, you've been saying that to me for a long time. It's taken a while for it to truly sink, like, really, you know, take those roots. But, and Kristen, too, you know, with your age, you're dealing with a lot more than just your own consciousness. You've got a lot of things going on within your physical body right now. You're getting a lot of influx of things that cause more impulse decisions. So that's why it's really important for you to put good things into your subconscious that when you do make those impulse decisions that you aren't scared of what is going to result because you know that they're coming from a good place. Does that make sense?
Reprogramming those neural networks, deconstructing the societal neural networks and constructing some that are a bit more functional and not self-destructive so that when that reflex and impulse does kick in, then your reflex is going to be more towards honoring, you know, your pace and your right to be you, and it's not going to be more towards being self-destructive or doing things that are going to get you into deep shit.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And,
People think that teenagers are a bit self-destructive because, oh, it's teen angst and that's just how teenagers are. No, it's because that's how society has taught them to freaking be, and they've got all these neural networks that have been put there by the mainstream media, by school, by parents, by this, by that, that when reflex and impulse kicks in, it defaults back to those neural networks, and those are the ones that are there. Those are the ones that have been programmed there. That has nothing to do with, oh, well, teenagers just do that. No, it's because the adults put all kinds of bullshit in their heads, so that's what they act on.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And, you know,
I love it how the grown-ups play kids. Like, oh, this world is so bad because, you know, kids these days, they're just, I can't believe this. It's like, wait a minute. Are babies, like, born into this world with a full hard drive? All the stuff that you don't like that they're doing, who put that there, huh? Gee,
right?
Talk about psychologically right? projecting and shit. What the fuck? Katerina's calling me on the other line, so I'm going to mute out for a moment.
Oh, okay. Well, then I will hang on here for a moment. And, Kristen, it's important for you to know that you will probably be alone in this as far as your friends go, and that's okay. Mm-hmm. You know, like, okay.
And the thing is, like, I go into these social situations, and I really do enjoy the people I hang out with, and the reason I know that they aren't receptive to the things that I want to talk about, and I can make small talk conversations, and basically all my in-person friendships has just been, like, superficial because I mention I'm spiritual. I mention very, just basically about metaphysics and what I think and how it affects me. But I am not able to really fully open up to anyone but really Dave and Rich, because I can tell some of my friends think it's stupid, some of them just don't understand it, and I don't have that many friends in person to begin with, so I just feel, I used to be very talkative, and that, as I've started to change, I am very uncomfortable with the fact that I've gotten more quiet, and I'd like to be cracking jokes and making everyone laugh and saying interesting things, and I'm currently at a spot where I don't have very many friends to do that with.
Okay, well, there's a couple of different...
I have made a couple friends, so that's nice, but...
Well, there's a couple of different things that rose up here while you were saying that, and the first thing is that you are a catalyst, and that's why you're alone. In your physical world right now is because you are the starting point. You're the beginning ripple, and that's okay. Now, understanding that you are the catalyst and that you have more knowledge than everybody around you physically, you know, you've got to accept it and be okay with it, and then just be yourself. Like, really just honor yourself fully and don't hold back, like, as hard as that may be, and you're going to have to do it in a little burst, just say things here and there, because you know what? Like, you being funny has nothing to do with your spirituality. It has nothing to do with metaphysics or any of that other stuff. That's part of who you are. It has nothing to do with what you believe. So you can still be that funny person, and you can still make those jokes, and you can still do that stuff, and what will happen is that you will... The more that you are yourself, the people around you will also be more of themselves. And if they refuse to, well, then they will exit your reality, and somebody who is will then come in. And you, you know, part of honoring yourself is honoring the ebb and flow of life and understanding that you are going to have lulls like this, you know, and that you are going to have influxes. And all of that is part of the process, because if you surrounded yourself, all of these people who just happen to be around you, that you happen to go to class with or whatever, you know, and you aren't feeling good around them, you know, they aren't giving to you, you are actually doing not only yourself, but you're doing them a disservice too by hanging around when you're not in alignment. So if that's where you need to start to help you honor yourself, is to start by honoring others first, and taking actions that, you know, honor them, honor you too. Eventually you can make that switch, because I feel like you have a hard time switching gears. Like, it's hard for you to, like, slam on the brakes and go in reverse or go right really quick. Like, you like that smooth transition. You like to know what's coming. You know, you understand you're going to have to move a little bit, but you want the, you just want to see it all so that you are entering dangerous waters. Is that, am I on? Is that right?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
So, the thing is that you don't have to see what's 50 yards ahead of you, because it's not here now. You'll see that when it comes close enough for you to do something about it. That is how the universe works. So if you're ready for your opportunity, the universe will give it to you, and then you can act, you know? But you're right now, what you're doing is you are taking your logical mind and looking 50 yards out in front of you and then trying to dictate your actions now, but then you're running into the trees that are right in front of you because you're failing to see what's right here, right now. Does that make sense?
Yeah, it does.
Okay, so when you address what's going on now and you make that move and you move around this tree that's right here in front of you, now as you're nearing that 50 yards and it becomes a lot closer, you realize the action you took 40 yards ago was the exact perfect action to set you up for what's coming up now right away. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Okay, so you're unknowingly setting yourself up for success just by honoring yourself right here, right now. And it really is that simple.
I mean, I know you're right, and I know, to me, it doesn't, even if it means, I have more, quote-unquote, friends by stifling what's really going on inside of me and not actually being open. It's not real friendship. It's nothing. It's not, I mean, obviously there's varying levels of friendship and everything, and so it's okay, you're allowed to have friends that aren't necessarily super close to friends, but I know in some cases I have kept probably myself from making connections because I've just withheld so much about myself in so many situations. Because I don't, a lot of the things I like to talk about are really kind of serious, and you know, when you're out in social settings, not everyone wants to hear about necessarily what's wrong with the world or super heavy topics, and that's just where my mind goes a lot. And that's what's made, that's why I just, for a lot of the time, I just don't bother making plans with people, or when I do go out, it's like, I can tell, you know, people aren't super responsive to it, and should I care? Is it, you know, a bad thing? They can be themselves, they cannot respond, but I just, naturally, I really want to be liked by other people. I know that's not just me. It's a lot of people experience it. I'd say most people do.
Yeah, for sure.
That's basically what I've been at. And I've been making new friends, and I noticed that a lot of the people that I'm friends with seem to be at the same level, knowing as far as the world that I was 3 or 4 years ago, and it's an interesting reflection for me because it's like they know that something is wrong with the world. They know that corruption exists, but they aren't understanding exactly how it works. And so when I get into these conversations, I would say I do know more about what's going on, but every time I try and talk about it, I know that I just sound like an insane conspiracy theorist because them.
Right, yeah.
Yeah, so that's kind of where I've been at. And actually, I have one friend of mine where we started talking about the state of the world, and he is set on the fact that he thinks the world is going to end in destruction, probably nuclear war. And I think that we are actually on the track to healing the world, but I have no idea where to begin to even start to tell him about that, and because it's such a drastic difference, and I know that probably the biggest reason I haven't been able to figure it out is because, you know, I'm thinking I'm overcomplicating, like you were saying before, about how I'm going to phrase it and if it's going to be good enough, as opposed to just saying how I feel, and
right,
you know, you can take it or leave.
Well, and two, something that I have found because you know, I work very closely with my intuition and my spirit guides and knowing and learning the signals, because there are signals constantly and we just have to pay attention to them. And I have found when I get into those moments where I am, and it happens a lot with my husband, he has very different, he's a self-professed atheist, and which is really funny because mm-hmm. here he's he's seen my mediumship in action, you know, but he still does not believe, you know. And how can I explain that to him? He's seen the proof. He's watched me make people, I don't want to say make, because it has absolutely nothing to do with me. I'm the channel. That's it. I'm the instrument. Mm-hmm. You know, but I'm channeling this divine, you know, I'm channeling spirit and to their loved ones, and the people here in the physical are bawling their eyes out when I'm speaking, you know, and mm-hmm. he's receiving messages directly, but he still won't admit that he believes, or maybe he doesn't, I don't know. But when I start to talk to him about these things, if it starts to feel like that, where it's like, where I don't really know what or how to say it, then that tells me that the conversation is done and it's time to move on. As much as I might want to continue it, it is not appropriate for me to do so, because all I will do is cause more confusion. And that's part of knowing, is being aware of that. And when you force in that situation, then you start to not honor yourself, because then it starts to get icky. So, like everything that you say, and this is something that, you know, you'll come to see if it hasn't already happened to you, is that years down the road, people will come back to you and say, hey, you said this to me and now it makes sense. You know, I'm telling Dave that stuff. Your stuff you told me last year is just now making sense, you know, and, or mm-hmm. I'm really getting it. And that's okay. So, it's okay to, you know, have conversations with people and they don't understand. And it's okay if the conversation to end before you feel like you've given all the information that you wanted to give. It's all that they can take, and there isn't anything more that you can do about it. And I would really encourage you to, in your mind, to set, to make particular times appropriate for the things you want to, and the times, and then set out times that aren't appropriate. So if you know that there's a particular group of people you hang out with where they have absolutely nothing, they want nothing to do with any of this stuff, well, then that's not the appropriate time. So instead of being like, oh man, I can't relate to anybody on this stuff, I really want to talk about this, but nobody understands. It's just, that's the time to play with them and to have the fun and make the jokes and say the stuff. And then you have your time later in the day where you talk to Dave or you talk to Rich, you know, or if you want to talk to me, you know, and that is your time to have that. So you look forward to it, just like your school schedule. You know, there's classes you really hate and there's classes you really look forward to. But when you're in math class, you're not trying to do science, you know. Doing that. So it's just that same sort of approach, and that is just for your own sanity and for your own heart, because this stuff is super important and you are going to want to talk about it to everybody and their mother, but that's just not realistic. So if you said you're having unrealistic expectations about how you can express yourself, and in turn that is not honoring yourself, which is why you're feeling so icky about it across the board, because you haven't given yourself that time to just and let it all go, you know? So
yeah, and that's why for the most part, I've given up. I mean, I will say over the summer, I ended up meeting this group of people, and they're all really cool, and I haven't really talked to them about anything metaphysics at all. We've kind of gotten into political discussions, and I've been open about the fact that I think the whole system is just set up to not be dysfunctional and everything, and so I had sort of bits and pieces, but the biggest thing is, a lot of the time, when we'll get going in group discussions or whatever, like, I make jokes, and I can banter with them and stuff, and it's great, but then there's other times when I just don't know what to say, because everything I want to say is either, I just don't know how they're going to take it.
Why can't you just enjoy yourself in the moment, just being present and enjoying the fact that everybody around you is having a good time? You don't always have to contribute to the conversation, you know, and not contributing to the conversation doesn't mean anything other than you're just enjoying yourself where you are. You know, like, maybe that's something you need to visit and see if you feel obligated to constantly contribute, to feel part of the group, because you should feel part of the group whether or not you're saying anything.
Oh, true. That's probably the biggest issue, or whatever you want to call it. I mean,
yeah. And you know, and the hugest thing that I will tell you, and it starts when you're younger, if nobody teaches you what a relationship should be, whether it's a friendship or a, you know, or an intimate relationship, if you don't understand what it is that you need to do, then you don't have a proper structure anyway. So it sounds like you don't know what your place is in the group, but you haven't talked to anybody about that, and nobody's going to talk to each other about it because you don't know, none of you know that you need to do that. Just to see where everybody's at, and you don't have to do it like a big group powwow and sit down and say, where do we stand with each other? It's something that you do, you know, individually with each person. And when you know where you stand with each person and what your relationship is with each of those people, then it's much easier to feel comfortable in the group because you've already cleared that all up. You understand that, you know, you just,
yeah,
just understand.
Yeah.
Boys, stop.
Let's do it. I really do see what you're saying, and that, see, and part of me would
be amazed. And that what?
That's another thing with, since I've just met, like, this group of people and made friends with them, it's kind of like, I'm not, and it's completely, it's completely societal, but it's like, for me, doesn't know, like, I know, I'd say we're fairly close, and part of me has, like, judgments about how much I should share, depending on what level of friendship it is, so, since we're not super close, it's like, I don't know how much of myself to share, and not even just about, like, the metaphysical stuff, just everything in general. So it's like, it's the awkward, should we be closer than we are? How do I get to know people for who they are?
Well, your mind is doing all the work in that, so.
And that's what? It's, I'm overthinking it because there can be ease and flow in getting to know people. I've experienced it myself, and there's no reason why I shouldn't be able to with any person, even if it's, we get along or not. And
absolutely.
You're absolutely right.
And it's, and this time too, like, and I don't know if anybody has, like, outright told you this, but now is your time to make mistakes. Now is your time
to learn all of the stuff, to, you know, find out which rules can be bent and which ones will break, and, you know, like, this is your time to figure out exactly how it is you want to live your life. You're putting, it's so much easier for you at your age to change something than it is for any of us at our age to change something, you know, until you get in the habit of being able to change things quickly, but that's our natural state, is being able to adjust really quickly. So everything you're experiencing is 100% completely normal, and there's absolutely nothing wrong with you. You need to make mistakes. In fact, make a few on purpose, and they might turn out to be happy surprises. You know, like, you never know. Like, this is like a safe point in your life where you really don't have anything to lose. You know, even if those people decide to not be your friends, well, what the fuck ever? There's 7 billion other people in the world. Somebody's gonna want to be your friend, okay? And not just somebody, but lots of people.
It means I'll be alone for a little while.
Yeah, you know, and it's, you know, we just get in the car, please. You know, and it's just about finding that childlike innocence again for life, where we just do things for the sheer enjoyment of them, regardless of when they're gonna, of how they're gonna turn out. I mean, my 4-year-old is a prime example of that. I mean, that kid gets in trouble so much, but he has a lot of fun. You know, and he doesn't care. Like, he'll break the same rule if, you know, 500 times if what it results in is fun for him. And he doesn't care that he gets in trouble, and he doesn't care that I get mad. He doesn't care if I yell. He's honoring himself, and, you know, he's teaching me to do that, you know, for myself and for everybody else too, and teaching me how to, you know, and teaching me how to honor myself and come from, you know, that place when I do have to address something, because, you know, sometimes honoring yourself is
confronting somebody. And that's okay. There's nothing wrong with confrontation. You know, it's necessary. Yep. You know? And, hold on just a second. Alright, trying to get the kids in the car seats. But I've noticed a huge change with my kids too, in just the, you know, they're honoring their places a lot more. You know, and they will, if they're mad and they can't like calm down and they're kind of starting to lose their shit, then they will literally go into their room and do that. You know, they'll go in their room and lose their shit for a while, and then they'll come back out when they're ready, you know, to contribute to the, you know, high vibration that I do my best to keep in the house. You know, and, you know, it's taken a lot more work on my part, but, you know, he's an important person in your life, period, hands down. It'll never be your children, it'll never be your other, it'll never be your parents, it'll never be your friends. It's you. And when you make yourself the most important person, and not in a selfish, arrogant way at all, but just by honoring yourself, wherever you are.
I'm back. I'm back, and I'm about to merge Katerina in to join us. Yay!
All right. And, you know, when you come from that high-vibing place, you know, you'll find that even the people who were most resistant to your change to begin with will just go like, well, whatever, and then move on, you know? There won't be any confrontation because you didn't allow it to begin, or you just didn't participate. And then eventually they stop doing all of those things, too.
Hey, Katerina.
Happy birthday.
Thank
you.
It's the birthday
Thank
girl.
You,
it's the birthday girl. Yay!
So what have you done today?
I went to a nude beach.
You went to a nude beach?
I went to a nude beach and I went swimming in my birthday suit. It was fun.
Yay!
Awesome. Swimming in your birthday suit on your birthday.
Right.
Swimming in my birthday suit on my birthday. And then I went out and had lunch with my sister and her boyfriend, and we just had
Where's
a fun
Paul?
Day. Paul is going to be home in like, I don't know, an hour maybe.
Oh.
He's about working today.
Katerina's just making Richard really want to go to Austin now.
Right? That's funny. No, the only other people around were, like, old men in their little beach chairs. That wasn't fun.
That reminds me that one picture. Remember, Rich, I was telling you the one old guy laying out in the beach chair, and then,
That's what all the younger beaches at Florida are for. If you're wanting to go that route, yeah. I'd rather be in Florida, honestly. I was going to be doing that. Because at least there's a lot of pretty women around instead of a lot of crusty old dudes with hairy chests that just make your eyes want to melt.
Yeah, they only really have the crusty, hairy old dude chest beaches around here. Sorry.
Yeah. I'd probably be hanging out in Houston anyway. That's where I'd want to be.
So the trick is showing up at the crusty old nude beach that Katerina is also at, so she can take your mind off of the crusty old guys.
Yeah. Like I said, if I'm going to Texas, I'm going to Houston. Sorry.
Oh, come on. If Katerina was running down the beach bouncing her gems like Pamela Anderson on Baywatch, I don't think you'd be paying attention to the crusty old dudes.
Oh, Lord.
And also, not that far from Houston. So you don't really have any excuses.
God, that's funny. So, Daphne.
So, Katerina.
So, guess what?
What?
Well, my friend Mary Adams and I haven't even told Dave this yet, but my friend Mary Adams and I got some invitations to go teach some classes out in the Phoenix and Sedona area, like, beginning of next year.
Woohoo!
Guess who I would come see?
Hell yeah! You could
totally come stay at my house.
I would come give you a hug. I would come love you.
Hell yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Then we could have a Google Hangout where we see Katerina and Daphne in person together with Mary Adams.
Mm-hmm. That would be fun.
Oh, it'd be so much fun. Yeah, you have to let me know when you get specific dates and all of that so we can make arrangements and...
Looks like you guys got a place to crash.
Oh my god, wow. Holy shit.
What?
Okay. So, I got a message the other day that I will be traveling in the early part of the year next year, like within the first 3 months of the year. And Sedona mm-hmm. is technically traveling.
Mm-hmm.
And it said that she told me that I was going to take like a little trip. It wasn't a vacation, but that it would be, you know, a few days away from home. So I wonder, mm-hmm. Yeah, you'll have to definitely get me the info on that.
Okay.
So, because I would like I might participate too.
Heck yeah.
So, and I would also love to help promote you out here. I know lots of people who would love to come to stuff. So.
Sounds good.
It'd be awesome.
Sounds good. Yeah, like there's so many possibilities happening here, like, because Mary has a lot of networks out there with, like, spiritual centers and, you know, just a lot of people who are in those circles. So they've just been like, when do you want to come? Like, we are ready to come. How do you come do that right now? Blah, 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 blah. So, but Mary and
awesome.
I, like, we want to get some stuff ready. You know, we have our classes going on now here. And we just did our first one on Saturday, and now we're going to do another one in October. And then we're doing them once a month. And then I'm probably going to be doing some classes in between then, just around the area, just on my own. And it'll be really exciting. And by the time we get to Arizona, we'll be all ready.
Hey, Katerina, you know what would be fun?
What, Dave?
Next time you're here in Chicago having a Google Hangout in the woods. And if there isn't a local Wi-Fi hotspot, which in those woods, last I checked in 2010, I was actually able to get Wi-Fi out there. But if there isn't, I can just always activate Cricket for a month, and I do have that little Cricket Wi-Fi, portable Wi-Fi router thing.
Are we gonna go out there and like meditate and feel our chi?
We can go out there and do whatever you want.
Go meditate and feel our kundalini rising through the earth, and out through our limbs, and down the earth through our roots, and up to the sky, and do all these like crazy meditations.
As like my kundalini penis rises as it extends them. But anyway, I think that the woods might be a nice change up of scenery than like, you know, the back wall of my room.
Yeah,
that's all I'm thinking.
Yeah, that's true. Totally. Totally, totally, totally. So where's Kristen?
She's here.
I'm here.
There she is.
Hi.
Hello, Katerina. Happy birthday.
Thank you for telling me happy birthday. It's been kind of like a not happy birthday today, though. So this is like the first, like, happy part, besides New Year's coming.
The old woman's 23.
Yeah, what?
Oh, crap.
Hey, Katerina, did you get my little happy birthday video that I posted to your wall?
I've got so many things on my wall right now. Like, I just have been clicking like, but I haven't actually looked at anything. Except for Daphne's little meme.
I was going to say, hey,
Katerina.
I made that especially for you.
Katerina.
Yes, Redridge.
I sent you, because that one day I was going through all that shit. I'm not going to say there's any reason as to why right now, because I don't think it's necessary at this point in time, but did you get that link I sent, that YouTube video of that dictator guy, and then, like, you know, he, like, drinks the Sprite or whatever, and then he's, like, all of a sudden, like, happy or whatever, and he's, like, dancing around?
Was that something you sent me on Skype?
Yeah.
Oh yeah, I remember I was gonna watch it, and then I got distracted.
It was a Sprite commercial, but I thought it fit because I was feeling kind of down and out that day because my energy level was like in the toilet because, you know, I was doing all that for contrast, and I was thinking to myself, oh, this is like perfect for this whole thing. It's like, basically it's Sprite, feel the freshness, but I was thinking, oh, instead of Sprite, you could just put Katerina's name in there and say, Katerina, feel the freshness. And he's going, can you feel it?
That's funny.
It comes in 2 1-liter bottles with a nipple head instead of twist off cap.
There you go.
Although
you can't see it right now, but I'm shaking my head.
you can twist that. You can twist the nipples, but you can't twist them off.
Well, that's
it's not a cap.
You had to take a good bubbly, ice cold, refreshing soda and turn it into bubbly.
Everything can be turned into a body part, can't it?
Yeah. Dave is an expert. Dave seems to be an expert at this.
Just for the taste of it, Katerina.
Oh.
Roy.
What's it called?
You mean inanimate objects, human qualities?
You just took a Dr. Pepper commercial and fucked it up.
It's not Dr. Pepper. It's just,
I remember there are
just for the taste of it, Diet Coke. That's what I was saying.
I've heard old Dr. Pepper commercials that are just like that. So,
well,
I think they
by Coke.
Well, they
I've
are
heard
kind
Dr.
of
I've heard
they
Dr.
are
Dr.
owned
Pepper
by the same
do,
company.
I've heard Dr. Pepper do the same type of thing.
Well, Dr. Pepper is technically owned by 7-Up now, which is technically a separate company, but I don't know if they're under the Coca-Cola umbrella tree.
I think Dr. Pepper is Dr. Pepper 7-Up Incorporated. They're their own chain, and then Pepsi, and then Coke.
Well, at some level up, they're all owned by the same corporation anyway.
Right. Yeah.
Because I've literally heard Dr. Pepper commercials that sounded just like that, for the taste of it type thing, similarly along those lines.
Mm-hmm.
But Katerina beverages are owned by Paul Roy Incorporated.
No, they're not. They're owned by Katerina.
Yeah. That's right. That's right, girl.
Paul has them on lease, and he pays for them every single month.
Yes, that is true. They're leased.
Oh. Next topic.
I want to know what's going on with Kristen.
Next topic.
I heard she was talking to Daphne, and then, like, I got on the phone, and then
the
that's
ogre,
quiet.
Next topic, the ogres of Pussy Mountain. Just kidding. No, go ahead, Kristen. What's been up with you?
Been going to school.
No, Carrie, when you got
home.
And then...
I've been to marching band, and I stopped.
Yeah, I love marching band. I still blind step sometimes.
And then?
I love that voice.
And then.
Dude, read my code.
Damn. My life is fairly uneventful. So then I come home and get on the internet. What's wrong with your head?
The more eventful.
What have you been having lately?
The more eventful stuff is rated P for privacy and is none of anyone's business.
Yep.
Right.
Oh no.
Movie not yet rated.
Well, see, and I took that as, like, you have internal stuff going on in your mind that you aren't sharing. All the activities going on in without. And then there the boys have to go again doing the boys stuff. You're like, come on, the four-year-old.
A void dance. We dance around the void.
I must have been dealing with central anxiety. Well, if you don't want to talk about fun stuff, I can talk about fun stuff if you want. My yucky stuff.
Well, I would love to hear.
Yes, Katerina, show Kristen that you're not this uber goddess ascended master that's perfect and so far above Kristen. Show her that you're human too.
Yeah, fuck that shit. Fuck that shit. So my sister today, she's been traveling and visiting and being here with me and stuff, and it's been bringing up a whole sort of family funness. But so today, the best part of the entire trip was that her dog is like in the middle of having all these issues, and he has like pancreatitis, and so she ended up having like a sobbing breakdown fit on my birthday, like while we were hanging out having a celebration, and then I have to like come and cater to her and her emotional needs, and I love doing that for people. At the same time, it's like the one day of the year that I want to be off duty, if that makes sense, and not like support everyone emotionally. Like, I just wanted to be selfish for once and just be able to, like, you know, have my fun and my celebration. And I was really pissed about it. I was really, really sad. And that was part of my not so fun day today. So I'm really happy that you and everyone on the phone.
Yeah. And your sister has no clue that she should be thankful that I wasn't physically there.
Why is that?
You know the sorts of things I would say, and she'd want to kill me.
Why? Well, you lay down the truth, paradigm shift, SmackDown.
Yeah. Just, you know, just being my honest self, kind of like what used to annoy you about me, and occasionally still does. But she's not used to that, so I think she'd, like, reach for the nearest frying pan and try to hit me with it.
You know, that's one of the things that I'm realizing, too, about all this paradigm shifting stuff is, like, the quantum year takes no coffee breaks, right? So, like, all of this stuff, even though my desire would be that it would just be a fun day all day long, there'd be unicorn kittens and, like,
can
candy and balloons.
Can I interrupt for just a second, Katerina, on that?
Well, yeah, what's up?
Okay, when you start out and saying about how you love to support people emotionally, and you want to introduce people to fun and the things that you like to do.
Uh-huh.
I'm the same.
I know.
I do
love supporting people.
So you got technically what you asked for, because you love to do it, you know.
Mm-hmm.
The universe is trying to make you happy, that's all.
You got what you asked for, viewed it as negative, and went,
yeah.
Right.
Continue. I wanted to.
Yeah. At the same time, though, I would have really, really loved to have that to be tomorrow, and I could just not have to do it. Because I love doing it, but I didn't want to love doing it today.
Yeah.
It was really, really hard, because...
Just like how you saw that your sister was causing herself her own stress, now it's being reflected that, oh, look, you're also causing yourself your own stress. Mirror, mirror, the universe is trolling you.
I'm being trolled.
You know, also having to come home for the day, so you know you have even more stuff to look forward to, and you got all the crap out of the way. Right?
That's true. That is
your
true.
Your wonderful husband is... You know, he's got something worked up to you. He loves you so much.
That's
like,
true.
You're already going for it. So, and you've got that contrast, so now because you started your day off, not ideally, that you can appreciate it even more so, whatever it is he does for you, even if it's just sitting quietly by your side and allowing you to enjoy your birthday celebration without any drama.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
You know, today of all days, Susan Worcester posted, like, the most appropriate, funny, frickin' picture to my profile. It says, it's a universe, you know, pyramid thing to where it's, like, got a little space scene in the middle of a glowing...
Oh, yeah.
At the bottom it says, shift happens, but the F is in parentheses, so it's read as shit happens. It says, you two can climb. Then above that it says, asleep. I don't want to know anything about this shit. Above that it says, curious. What is this shit? Above that it says, waking up. I have a lot of shit. Above that it says, awake. I'm seeing my own shit. Above that it says, enlightened. Helping others deal with their shit. And at the top of the pyramid it says, ascended master. Holy shit! It's all perfect. So of all mm-hmm. the days that she could share a picture, she shared that on this day. Universe trolling again.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm used to the universe trolling. It happens a lot.
Yeah.
Meanwhile, and a good thing that did happen was that there was a photographer at the restaurant that I was at, and I've been, like, wanting to manifest some new pictures for my website. And she was going around taking pictures of people at their tables, and because this is kind of a touristy place. And she was like, hey, do you want to trade chicken? I'm like, no, not right now, though your card, so I could actually, like, be able to, you know, have a studio shoot with you. And I was like, how should you charge? And she's like, well, I just charge like $30. And I'm like, what? That's ridiculous cheap. Okay, let's do it. And so I got her phone number, and I'm going to go in about 10. So I can have awesome. You photos from my website. So that was really cool.
Great.
Yeah.
Meanwhile, in the Batcave, as JP plays, while going, Richard, your impression sucked, dick.
Like, oh yeah, well, you fucking people don't own guns, you get raped by government, so there.
It's illegal to be homeless where you are, so there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. We have freedom to tinker here in the United States, you people have the freedom to suffer.
We're British. We pride ourselves on our suffering.
Obviously. You can see that very well. Your pompous attitude shows it so well.
Love and light until my butt is hurt, then fuck you.
Then fuck you.
You don't have enough content.
And if Rochelle was online, he'd be like, oh, and then the whiny one, who doesn't seem to know when to shut up.
Oh.
Even though I think she's so adorable. Horrible, but I just can't say it because I'm so butthurt by her cuteness. I feel a homosexual twinge coming on. Hans, fuck me in the ass, please. My big wide anus is feeling very itchy and butthurt. We've got this guy with actually excellent voice impressions that I can't even do because I have a gay little soundboard. Hans, rape me. I need to feel love.
Hans, just grab onto my beard. I don't have handlebars.
Oh, yeah. Me from Switzerland. Me terminate asshole.
Okay.
Arnold Schwarzenegger in Machine Gun Dick. You ain't seen him coming.
He'll be in your back, side.
I'll be back.
Side.
On your ass.
I'll be back, side.
I was on California's back side. They went bankrupt.
You know, I don't Execute think I've ever all... had a conversation with just my girlfriend where it starts to go into all sort of, like, sex-related funny stuff. I don't think that's ever happened in the history of just women.
Execute order 69, I want to fuck.
Unless you're Betty White. I haven't had a conversation
Oh,
with
yeah,
her.
Of course, women never, ever get sexual when they talk in private. No,
they're just
little perfect nuns that just sit in prayer circles and go, isn't it so wonderful to be female? And no, they don't talk about anything.
Well, it's just, it's more like straightforward and to the point. You know, like, mm-hmm. we don't turn genitals into live objects of some sort. It's just like, was it big? Yeah. Was it good? Oh, yeah. You know, but
yeah, females don't ever partake in any sexual humor. Nah, they would,
oh, it's just
they would never do that.
Oh,
that
no,
ever.
Never,
oh,
ever,
oh,
ever.
This goes on a perfect topic. One of my high school friends, which I'll leave her name out of it, but we were having a conversation the other night, and you know, there was this other friend of mine, you know.
So-called friend, apparently not.
So-called girlfriend of mine, you know, who was a buddy of mine's ex-girlfriend. But I thought this was funny because apparently she thought I was creepy. This was before the other girl that I'm really good friends with got to really know me. This was a couple of years ago. But Basically, the other girl called me creepy because apparently I looked at her bosoms or whatever, and she thought that was creepy, but I was sitting there laughing my ass off because I'm thinking to myself, okay, so, number one, I probably haven't ever been the first. I'm not going to ever be the last. But apparently me admiring a woman for her physical beauty is a crime against humanity, and you should have your eyeballs gouged out with a crowbar if you do, because if you look at a woman any other way, you're a criminal, and you're a pervert and a rapist and an anti-misogynist, and you're this crazy weirdo, and, you know, I mean, I'm just sitting here like, you know.
Oh, it's worse than that. If you don't admire her breasts, then, oh, well, you know, you're not acknowledging her beauty, and you're just being a meanie face. Either that or you're a homosexual. But then if you do it's like, oh, you're a creepy scumbag. How dare you?
Well, only because you're not the guy she wants to look at, that's all. So yeah, anybody who's
exactly.
Not who she wants to look at her is not automatically a creep, you know?
And anybody who she wants to look, but they aren't looking, well, they're not acknowledging my beauty. They're a hater. They're gay. Or I must be inadequate or whatever, you know. It's like damned if you do, damned if you don't. When girls see assholes as being the only real reality, then they can't see all the nice guys around them.
Oh, wait,
believing
that's,
is seeing.
That's the interesting thing. I mean, Steve, my buddy Steve, who she dated, nice guy all the way around, good guy. He joined the Army. He's in the Airborne right now. I'm super, super proud of him. He's, you know, he's an outstanding individual. You know, he's doing his duty for his country. He's protecting our country. You know, he's at least a decent military man, not, you know, like a lot of these crazy industrialists among our general.
Now, if only Obama would just let him bomb ISIS. Damn.
Yeah, there you go. But, anyway. Essentially what happened is she broke up with him because he was changed. That was her words for it. Changed. The Army changed him, and he became rude, and, you know, blah, 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 blah.
Well, the Army certainly did change him. I will vouch for that, but that doesn't mean he's rude.
Well, yeah. No, the Army, that's like the understatement of the year. It's like, yeah, the military does change you.
He's probably just more confident.
He's more confident. He's a man.
He's
more
used to speaking his mind. It's probably what's affecting her.
Well, absolutely. And my husband is retired military. He's been 10 years in. He's the most forward, polite, and frank person I know.
Yeah.
And I thought the same thing, but it just comes to find out, well, you know what? When you're in the military, you have to talk like that because you don't have time to pussy talk.
Yeah, no.
Yep.
No, he is
somebody's life on the line, literally.
Yeah. No, and every day for him, even when they're on training missions, every day for him could be the last, you know. On one of the training stories he did, they did a parachute jump in a thunderstorm because the general was having a hard-on and wanted to get some troops on the ground right now because he was impatient, stomping his feet, and temper tantruming like a little bitch. But they lost two guys in that thunderstorm.
Oh.
And he landed in his buddy's blood. That's how bad that thunderstorm was. He landed in his buddy's blood. He was dead. He was dead. He was gone. Dead. Not there anymore. And, you know, hearing that from him, I could, you know, I'd look in it, you look in the guy's eyes, you know he's telling the truth. That shit changes you. Whether it's training or whether it's actual combat,
That sort of general should be shot for treason.
Oh, absolutely. No, I would do that general, but, you know, if anybody's watched Braveheart, when William Wallace got his local landlord kicking him downhill and then put his head and slicing his neck with a knife, that's pretty much what those guys need.
Well, the reason my husband is retired from the Army is because of a mistake like that by his superior, who did not allow them to use any loom, any light, and they ended up crashing.
Mm-hmm.
They crashed $2 million tank and totaled it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and everything. So that's, unfortunately, it's a very common thing that happens in the military because all these guys get power hungry for that stuff. And my friend, you know, lost a friend in the military too, and he wasn't even there. And it messed him up. So I can only imagine what this poor guy is experiencing landing in his front.
Yeah, I think it would only be fair to send that general up in a thunderstorm and you know, push him out with a parachute, but make sure that when he pulls the cord, pots and pans fly out like one of those Looney Tunes cartoons.
Well, I mean, Steve amazingly is actually picking, you know, very well. I mean, he's taken in a lot better than, you know, I know 90% of people out there would, or even more than that. You know, he's very mentally sound to be able to just be able to talk about it in a calm, you know, matter of fact manner. Is like it happened, you know.
We need more good generals like Patton was, and not these power hungry pussies.
Well, they're out there. It's just that the military, for years, has been under an agenda to rout those guys out, push them out, roust them out. They don't want those kind of people. They don't want Douglas MacArthur's. They don't want General George S. Patton's. They don't want guys who have been in the rank and file and know what's going on out there. They don't want those kind of guys.
They want power-hungry, scumbag psychopaths.
Yeah, they don't want they don't want Admiral Bull Halsey's or Chester Nimitz or any of those types of people. They don't want those kind of guys because those kind of guys are humans first, and they know what it means to be out there on the front lines. They know what their men are going through. They know what their men are thinking. And they're smart.
And they won't commit genocide.
And they will not commit genocide.
Technically, guys, the generals and all of those things, they start out as officers and lieutenants. They have a 4-year degree. And they come in and they are actually enlisted, most of them. So that's not 100% across the board. A lot of them get indoctrinated.
Well, yeah, not 100%. But I'm just saying, in the current administration, generals tend to be appointed if they kiss Obama's ass enough. Or Bush, whatever psychopath is currently in charge.
Well, right, but for him to get to that general ranking, he had to start out as an officer, not an enlisted man who goes into, you know, the E rankings. They actually start out in charge of everybody, including the E7s, E8s that have been in the military for 20 years. You got some new, they call them butter bars.
Yeah.
You know, a second lieutenant who comes in who has never done anything. He just got out of college, you know, spent 4 years in college, and hopefully he's gone to West Point, which he may or may not have gone to. And with all that means, he's just indoctrinated even more so.
Yeah.
To do whatever it is that the government wants them to do. So they but they never really get to experience the true enlisted man journey. It's a completely different unless they've, you know, went enlisted and got a degree, and then they, you know, then their enlistment ended, and then they re-enlisted as an officer. But otherwise, you know, it's very not common for them to have actually gone through that experience of, you know.
Unfortunately, even with the enlisted ones, you know, they only raise the guys up through the ranks that are bloodlusting psychopaths, and the good people they push back, because that's just the way the administrations have been for the last 20-plus years, dare I say.
Well, absolutely, and having, you know, been on all sides, I actually have a friend who's a drill sergeant right now, and it's such an unconscious process, and it happens, like, the indoctrination of the military instills all of that, so everybody who's actually doing all of that work doesn't even know that they're doing it. And it's the most horrible thing. I've seen so many servicemen get out, and they're literally just destroyed mentally.
What it is it's total compartmentalization of the military. I mean, it's, you know, that's where they break everything down, is through compartmentalization. I mean, you see it in the legal system, you see it in, you know, the medical system, you see it everywhere. It's
especially with cops.
Police department, everything.
Yeah.
You don't see any communication, you don't see, it's all just little tiny sects, it's all broken up, and it's controlled, micromanaged that way. Now, I will say, out of experience, out of, you know, knowledge and, you know, things, stuff through documentaries and things of the nature, the military, most of the military does just the way Daphne, but the Marines on hand are different.
Hey, guys.
What's up, Katerina?
I need to make a phone call, so I need to let you guys go.
Alright, if you want to return to this call, then just message me on Facebook when you're done, and I'll bring you back in.
Okay.
Thanks for showing up, though. Hope you had fun.
Yeah, and you know, I'm gonna take this opportunity to go too. I just got my oldest son from school, so I'm gonna dip out. Well, it's a good time.
Alrighty. Bye. Well, thank you guys for showing up, and happy birthday, Katerina, and cheer up.
Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah.
Love you.
All right. Love you all.
Love you guys.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
Yeah. But anyway, as I was saying, Daphne was correct on that, in the fact. That's really how they do it now, especially in the only real experienced pilots I will say, or officers will say that they're really churning out anymore, are pilots. Those are really the guys that, you know, are above the rest.
Yeah.
Because they go through training and they go through all the, they go through survival and all that stuff. I mean, they train those guys to front lines just like infantry, so the pilots kind of know what's up. They know what's going on.
I was just going to say that with cops, unfortunately, the way the police academy is now, if you get too high a mark, you fail. If you get too low a mark, you fail. Because, you know, most people think 80% of cops are bad. No, 80% of cops aren't bad. They're incompetent. The system is designed so that they accept mostly people who are just smart enough to take orders and do their job and dumb enough to not question them. And, you know, they treat being a cop like it's a video game or something.
But anyway, going to the Marines, on the other hand, have a system that I think the entire military all across the board ought to go with. Before you become an officer, you have to go through infantry training. You have to learn how to set up trenches. You have to learn how to set up ambushes. You have to learn how to do everything that a pilot would do. And that's pilots, that's desk clerks, that's everybody in the Marines. They have to learn how to be first and foremost combat-ready riflemen. They have to know how to, you know, lay line. They know how. They have to know how to do all of the things that an basically trained infantryman can do. They have to learn. They have to be a grunt. They have to learn how to do everything. You know, sand and mud. You know, boots soaked and cold and uncomfortable and haven't eaten in 3 days. They have to go through all the training that the infantry go through before they get to go on to their advanced officer training. They just get whisked in. Oh, here you go. You know, here's your officer's pins, and here's your nice, clean, little, squeaky uniform, you know. They have to literally do everything that an infantryman would have to do before they're allowed to even go out into the field and start commanding Marines. And under that system, I think it would really knock out a lot of that chaff, if you will. It would get rid of anybody who just wanted to be there because they wanted the position for power. Because they wouldn't be willing to do what it takes to actually be there because they want to be there, and they want to help people, and they want to lead Marines, and they want to be in our nation's best.
Hey, Rich, you and Kristen talk for a few minutes. I will be right back.
Okay. So what are you up to, Kristen? Are you here? Yeah. Kristen? Hello?
It's showing her it's connected on the line.
okay.
Sorry. I totally muted it, and I forgot to unmute. Okay, that was stupid. Anyways.
That's all right.
What I'm going to do is convince my mother to stop by Culver's and get me some pumpkin salted caramel ice cream.
Oh, God, that sounds so good.
Oh, it is so fucking good. Like, I used to work there, and Jesus Christ, I started working there right as soon as it came out.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, it was, my God. You know what? Yeah, I'm about to call my mom right now. So she's coming home from work. Okay. So then I'll call back, okay?
Okay.
Priorities.
Okay.
Talk to you later.
Yep.
Okay, well, I'm back. I just need to grab something to eat.
Yeah, Kristen said she would. We're going to have to call Kristen back, so she said she'd call us back, but I know how that's going to go. You're going to end up having to call her because
yeah, exactly.
Get on the call. But anyway, she's going to talk to her mom about something really quick, call her and tell her about something. And so, yeah, she said she'd call back.
All right, that's no problem. I'm just having her telling her I'll merge her back when she's done. Definitely an interesting call, kind of an on-the-fly PSEC episode.
Sure.
But he consented for it to be that.
Mm-hmm.
And yes, I also made it known to Katerina before joining her, because she had called and I was talking to her just off to the, on the sidelines about things, and invited her on and told her, you know, just so you know, everybody consented for this to be public, so don't say anything you don't want the world to know. Notice it's been getting easier and easier to get more and more people on lately.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
We're just kind of starting to move in that direction, and that's really cool.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, hell, the one we did with Vinny, we had like 5 people in total.
Mm-hmm.
How long was Kristen gone before I came back?
Gone for at least somewhere around there. I don't know. I wasn't keeping track. I'm just making a guess.
I was just curious as to how many minutes of silence I'm going to end up cutting out of this.
Just where I got done talking about the Marine thing before you just left.
Yep.
Yeah, I'm glad I did. I didn't know that that was going to be a PSEC episode, so I'm kind of glad I didn't need detail anything.
Well, I got your consent at the same time as I got everybody else's. I heard you say, yeah. I mean, I'm not going to include any of our conversation that is, you know, prior to calling Kristen and Daphne and such.
Okay.
So, you know, nothing prior to that. And, of course, while they were on and you hadn't really said much yet, and I just asked if it's okay with everybody if we could make this a public PSEC episode, and you all said yes, and I heard you say yes as well. Everybody consented, so I'm like, okay, cool.
I did step away for 5 minutes. I don't know if I caught you saying that or anything.
That was prior to your exit.
Well, actually, I was gone for, like, 2 minutes before that, and then I just came back to let you know that I was about to vacuum, so I don't know.
I'm pretty confident that I heard you say it's fine by me or something to that effect.
I didn't say anything like that. Well, it's... but... I'm too personal anyway. Not a big deal.
Yeah, because I did let everybody know. I didn't know you were gone. If you were gone at that point, so. That's why it's a good idea to let people know. I told Kristen I'd merge her back in when she's done, and she acknowledged, and I asked her if she's done right now, or if she's just acknowledging that I said words to her, and she understands.
That was kind of funny. You're like, oh, come on, Rich. You wouldn't want to see Katerina running down the beach with her gyms bouncing up and down like on Baywatch?
Like Pamela Anderson.
Hey, if I saw a pretty girl running down the beach like that, yeah, I would look, definitely. I'd be like, huh?
I think that would take your attention away from the crusty old guys.
Well, yeah, for a moment being, and then I would leave.
Yeah, Katerina needed some cheering up, so this was perfect. And she hasn't spoken with Daphne in quite a while either, so that was a good opportunity as well.
Mm-hmm.
Hell, you've spoken with Katerina more recently than Daphne has.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we hadn't been that long since me and Katerina got on the line.
Yeah, not at all.
It's funny, I started kind of complaining, man, we haven't Katerina in a while, and then Katerina starts popping in, you know. It's like, oh, you want more Katerina, do you? Well, there you go. There's plenty of Katerina now. Shut up.
You weren't putting up any blocks against it.
Uh-huh.
And then here she is again.
Mm-hmm.
It's going to be interesting to see how long this episode is, because I have no fucking idea.
Mm-hmm.
I haven't eaten all day until now.
Mm. I love this 720p copy of Mission to Mars. This is like an excellent copy. 1080p, it'd probably just be annoying. You'd be able to see their dimples on their face. (clears throat) 1080p HD is cool for some things, but when it comes to, like, movies, it generally isn't that good. Because then, like, makeup lines are visible, and, you know. Studio
1080p is actually really good for special effects and shit, like you got a really good space movie or something. It's like,
well, oh, yeah, for God. That. Yeah. I bet Mission to Mars wouldn't be too bad in 1080p. But 720 is perfect. I mean, it's just as good. It really brings the special effects out. Gives them a pop.
That movie's an oldie but a goodie.
Not really an oldie. I mean, it's only 15 years old. 2000 is still pretty recent.
Yeah. Barely, but still, it's, you know, we're going to be in 2016 soon.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's hard to believe. I remember when that movie was only 4 years old. That was when I first watched it. I was 8 years old.
Man, now you're looking back like, geez, where did time go?
it was good then, and it's still good now. The effects are still excellent. You know, I think they ought to make another Mission to Mars, only make the plot a little different to where, like, everything goes just right. Or the plot goes super well.
Or just continue it where they left off, and you get to see where that guy goes.
Yeah, get to see where Gary Sinise ends up.
Yeah, and he's like, oh, cool, you guys got to come back with me so I can show my friends. And they're like, oh, well, your mode of travel wasn't warp drive, it was stasis. Fuck!
They've been long gone. Well, no, if you look at the end of the film, it was what appeared to me to be warp drive, because he goes, and he shoots off, and it, like,
yeah, but even if it, but that, it would still have that effect even at sublight. Because sublight's still pretty fast. I mean, you're doing more than 3/4 the speed of light. You know what I mean?
Well, yeah, depending.
That's still going to look like, psh. I mean, if you're there just, you know, casually floating around Mars and this thing goes up and, you know, sublight. You know, look at the contrast and speed. So it was fast, it just wasn't necessarily, you know. And plus, the closer you get to the speed of light, time slows down for you, which means it speeds up outside. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, when they say that, like, a trip to, you know, Alpha Centauri would take 2 years at the speed of light, or just slightly, that's not how the physics works. It, from your perspective, traveling to Alpha Centauri, it would actually be extremely fast. But because as you approach the speed of light, time slows down for you, it speeds up outside of you.
Well, yeah, that's going...
So it would be a lot more than 2 years going
by. Yeah, no. No, it, under traditional mechanics and given the physics, yes, you're correct, but... I guarantee you most alien civilizations have probably figured out what a warp bubble is.
Oh, yeah, I know.
Which is what NASA has been already theorizing, and if we've just figured it out, they've already. So, you know, the ship, probably most likely you could write it in that the ship had a warp bubble, and it just went, boop, and it just took only, like, you know.
A minute.
Yeah, like 10 minutes to get there or whatever. Went into slipstream mode and just, you know. It was just maybe that their inertial dampening system, i.e. filling the thing with water, so that way you're just kind of in suspended animation, you know.
Yeah.
So that way it's not like a gold, you know, mothership, and, you know, you go from going fast to, like, shoo, into the wall. Well, we're here. Man, you need to work on your inertial dampeners.
Oh, by the way, that reminds me, on a Stargate SG-1 episode I watched the other day, they did more trolling with the theme song. There was this formal, like, reception, you know, dance party or whatever, you know, like the old school type, everyone's, you know, suit and tie and dress and, you know, piano music and everything. And there was, like, this classical piano version of the Stargate theme playing in the background. So he did it again. It's really subtle. It was an episode I had seen before. The first time I had watched it, I didn't catch it. This time I did. And I'm not actually sure how long Kristen's going to take.
Oh, who knows.
Should we end the episode here or keep it going or what? I mean, I don't have to end the call to end the episode.
Yeah, it's up to you, man. I mean, hell, we could, you know, take cut scenes out of the next call and, you know, just continue from there. Because it's all pre-recorded and you can just cut out what doesn't belong and put in what does.
Yeah, well, I also want it to be as little work for myself as possible, not creating a lot more.
Well, if you just use Windows Movie Photo, Windows Movie Editor, it'd be much easier.
Oh, yeah. Okay, Mr. Flake.
Caden Live sucks. Suck.
Oh, Kristen wants back in, so apparently we're still going. Talk about the universe answering my question for me there. Okay. Gonna bring her back in.
Dave's a psychopath, James is a con artist, and
you're a communist,
Rick is a communist hick and tater twat.
Apparently.
Yeah, if he ever watches this and he hears me say tater twat.
But he wouldn't watch it because only nobody's watching this.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Well, he's stalking James, whom he just called a con artist. I mean, that guy's a fucking flake. He's just weird. Stalks everybody he dislikes.
He hasn't stalked me yet, but who knows? Maybe my turn's coming.
Who knows?
The mailbox belonging to
Kristen.
Okay.
Is full and cannot accept me.
She messaged me on Facebook to bring her back in, but then it's like, Kristen is saying, try again. She's saying, ring. is she on?
Yeah.
There you are.
Hey.
Remember, this is still being recorded for public output.
Is it being recorded?
Yeah, remember earlier when I asked, is it okay, everybody? I recorded PSEC
20. Yeah, I didn't know.
And everyone's like, yes. I'm just letting you know, we're still in it.
Would you mind if we ended it? Because I have something kind of private. It was what I was going to tell you guys earlier.
Sure.
I don't think our YouTube following will care to hear about it.
Well, not all paradigm shifts must be public, so thank you everybody for listening, and, catch you all later, and hope this was enjoyable, for you all. We had on, Dave Kelso, Time Warrior, myself, Richard Hamilton, GeneralTate, Daphne Dugan, Thinking Kristen, known as, Kristen Meyer, and Katerina Roy, whatever you want to call her. It was a total frickin' party line, man, and we did a lot of facing of shit and having some fun discussions and getting a little bit dirty in a George Carlin, Bill Hicks sort of way, and yeah, it was all good. So take care and see you next time, and hasta luego, and happy Trash Panda and whatever. So we're out.